just before taping, I turned the two lights on, and this bee came in, and it went to one light. It was frantically moving about and flying there, and then it would go to the other one, and then it would go to the other one, and then back and forth, and it was just going through this hard to describe the intensity of its gyrations and buzzing and flying, like the light was some great flower or something. But it kept going. Is it neither this one nor that one? Is it, no, it's not this one. Okay, it's that one. No, it's not this one. It's that one. Neither nor. It's neither nor. Neither nor. Being, be, being. So being is saying neither nor practice. Neither nor practice. Neither nor practice. There's infinite wisdom behind this, and I'm working on this today. I like the tape every day to follow up and reassure everyone that everything is fine, everything's going on, because we're getting into very amazing territory here. And, the whole United Nations thing has brought up an enormous amount of recognition in my life in this planet, and it's just reverberating. So, oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. I mean, it is just, it's ongoing, what's arising now. So I'm just letting that, letting the wow of that, letting it evaporate. Keep in mind, there's only one problem, and everyone has the exact same problem. That's continuity fear. Everyone's doing the dance of continuity fear here, pretty much, right? And even those who are spiritual are doing the dance of continuity fear. And most of them, they may have the rhetoric down, but the continuity fear is still there. So that's it. So we don't need to judge anybody. I mean, what is there to judge? Continuity fear. Okay. So, but is that as opposed to what? No continuity fear? Well, no, because we realize there has to be an intermediate step between continuity fear and no continuity fear. You might say honoring our creativity, honoring our continuity fear, actually, is a way to look at it too. And that's what we're after here. That's absolutely what we're after. And so the Holy Spirit has been enlightening me today to an extraordinary extent. And yet the personality remains the same. I find that the personalities always remain pretty much the same. So don't worry about your personalities going to change. We're not even trying to do anything with the personality, actually. Personality is just a dance of continuity fear. That's all it is. And yet it's the aim is deeper than the personality. So the personality seems to me, it just remains stable. Always has. But underneath is where the transformation, where the continuity fear is smoothing out and giving, this is the dreams that happen, just extraordinary dreams I continue to have, which show this massive smoothing out just beneath the personality, just beneath the surface, as it were. So we're not worried about personality. Personality will stay the same, pretty much, right? We're not trying to change it. We're not trying to reorder, do anything with the personality necessarily. What we're doing is this practice, neither nor, which is to come upon this neutral, zeroed out, neutral definitional stance. Now, again, this I'm continuing with this practice, and feel fine. It's been fantastic. It's been tremendous in terms of bringing up, going through all this continuity fear that's evaporating, and you see it evaporating. You say, wow. Oh my gosh, I've been doing that dance my whole life. I've been doing, this is part of the dance I've been doing. United Nations, oh my God, it's been really controlling the global narrative. It's been 70 years. October 24, 2015 is 70 years, United Nations. Okay, it was founded in October 24th, 1945. So they're having this huge, blowout 70th anniversary. 70 years, Daniel, book of, the Bible, 70 weeks, 70 years of the UN, pretty interesting stuff. And I'm waking up and I'm seeing how my life has been controlled, co-opted by the agenda of the United Nations, and they it's like they have their tentacles everywhere. And it's, I mean, I grew up, I realized, I'd forgotten this. I mean, I grew up in a time when the United Nations was the greatest hope in the world. And being this from the intellectual classes, middle class intellectual class, academic intellectual class of surroundings, everybody I knew was this way. I mean, the United Nations was it. And everybody was huge boosters of this. My gosh, in the 60s, for instance. And you know, Haile Selassie from, that's how you pronounce his name, from Ethiopia, was this superstar going around saying, you know, we're an enlightened age and we're going to bring, no disrespect to the Rastafarians, I'm just talking in relation to the United Nations. And, I mean, the buzz was tremendous because we were trying to prevent World War III, okay? And I realized I was brought up to be in service to the United Nations. I was brought up in theosophy, actually. I read all the theosophy books, Alice Bailey books, Duacqua, read them all, studied them all. And as I said, I got super depressed. I got very, felt very, 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 this was not what I really wanted to do. But that was the ideology upon which the United Nations was actually founded, this theosophy. New group of world servers, you know, bringing about this new age, ushering in the new age here in the planet. And this permeated my life, and to an extent I didn't realize. I've been trying to get free of it my whole life. It's really quite something. It's very insidious, very much insidious. My gosh, I see what's happened in my life, and they tried to use me, you know, for their agenda. Their agenda is very in the mental consciousness of this planet. This agenda has a big, 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 big push, and tries to suck everything into it. Now, back then, we didn't have Agenda 21, we didn't have high technology, we didn't realize that Agenda 21, there's an agenda behind that, which is artificial intelligence, and behind that is a cosmic corporate culture, actually. And this agenda is going to use the United Nations as a facade to gain control, have its agenda gain control of this planet, artificial intelligence. And we're in way over our heads here, way over our heads. So it's not so benign anymore, actually. Back in the 60s, we thought United Nations was the greatest thing ever, and we're finally going to bring this multilateral peace and solve all the world's problems, etc. Well, have we solved the problem of artificial intelligence? Because this is the worst problem we have right now, actually. And there are some savants in the tech community who realize that too. And they occasionally, they, you know, peep, do a little peeping, and then, you know, chirp, chirp, chirp. You know, this is getting out of control, folks. Chirp, chirp. I don't think we really have this in control, or in control of it anymore. And of course, but they'll say, oh no, the United Nations goal, we got to get everybody, you know, sustainable development goals, we got to climate change, blah, blah, blah. So we got to use all this technology, and this is going to be great, et cetera. And it's not going to be so great, et cetera. So there's just been this realization of how controlling it is. I mean, it's been controlling the spiritual narrative on the planet also. It really has. It's been using Eastern teachings. Theosophy was very big on Eastern teachings in a lot of ways, to you know, keep promoting this certain kind of narrative. Now, the narrative that the Holy Spirit has given me and Jesus has given me is quite different. It's quite different, which ultimately has gotten to the realization that the existence is the Son of God, which is, again, not some separate soul or anything. They're not souls. They're just spirit. It's one mind, spirit. It's an extension of God. God extending itself is what we call the Son of God. It's not God creating some separate entity or anything. It's an extension of God, but the extension is not the one doing the extending. The prime creator is, it's like creation has like a direction. It comes from the prime creator doing the extension of God is both God and God the Spirit, as it were. God the Spirit is trying to see what it would be like to be great, to be the prime creator. Okay, so it's trying to reverse the direction of creation. This is what Jesus says. This is what we're trying to do. Now, the explanation of Jesus is quite different than Eastern religions. Okay, Eastern religion says that Brahman is the Leela, God is sporting with itself as the world, as people and everything, and God is just doing this for the enjoyment of doing all this stuff, you know. And what Jesus says is entirely different than that. And the United Nations has been promoting this, you know, agenda of the Eastern way because it fits in with its agenda a lot better. It says the world is wonderful. Let's make a perfect world. Let's bring heaven on earth. If we knew what reality really was, the idea of bringing heaven on earth, it would be the funniest joke ever. Okay, it's absolutely ludicrous. And yet this is the agenda that they're pursuing. Okay, so spirit wants to reverse the direction of creation. So what spirit did was it dreamed up this scenario, which we find as existence here. Bodies, worlds, universe, time, space, process, form, all this. It's a dream that spirit's having, but spirit's dreaming this dream for a purpose, not just to enjoy all this stuff. Not at all. Not at all. I mean, who's really having fun here? Nobody really. They say they are, but they're lying. Okay. It's part of the scam. We're trying to get God to believe that this dream that we're dreaming, spirit is dreaming, is God's true creation. They say, hey, God, this is your true creation, okay, and that other was just a memory you had. We're the ones who actually did the other, you know, the formless spirit, perfect, free, formless spirit in the realm of pure ideas and knowing this is true creation. So we want to say that we're the authors of that, and God's the author of this other something, all right? So we're trying to trick God into and say, hey, God, you know, you forgot your real creation. Here it is, bodies, enjoying, you know, their sport here in the world, in this world, this garbage dump. And, you know, basically rotting, pus-filled corpses, enjoying sporting around, walking around a garbage dump, rotting, stinking carcass of a garbage dump is what this world really is. And we say, God, this is your true creation. And the other, that's just a memory. That you're having a false memory that you created, that you didn't really create that. We did. You know, we did. So we're trying to do a switcheroo here with God. We're trying to deceive God. This is what Jesus says. We're trying to deceive God. He says it's an attack on God. It's an attempt to deceive God, and it doesn't work. All right. This is vastly different than most of the Eastern teachings, at least what they have culled out of it. You know, now if you really look at it, this is just a tradition there. They don't want to, because of the continuity fear, they don't want to rock the boat, the teachers. So they say, oh, sure, yeah, this is God, blah, 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 don't worry. And then just practice. See, the Eastern approach, which is correct in its emphasis on practicing, as is what we're saying here, our emphasis on practicing, they say, like, don't worry about it. Like Ramana Maharshi say, look, why is this happening? He says, don't worry about it. Just practice, you know, just inquire. Find the root of the eye, see if the eye really exists. They tend to agree with self-delusion and say, yeah, sure, of course, yeah, don't worry about it. Yeah. But practice. Do this practices. So this is how they do it. And I don't know, you know, if that's necessarily wrong or not, but we need to understand this. Just because all these teachers in Eastern history have said various things about this world, see, we interpret in a certain way, think, oh yeah, the world's great. This is what God loves, this world. God, you know, this is a divine sport and God is enjoying and this is so wonderful. That doesn't mean this is what they really believe at all. Okay, and if you hear some of the stuff between the cracks, which I have, you know, like Ananda Maima said, you know, people say, why should we practice? Why should we practice? He says, why should you flee a massacre? You know, this is her answer. Really, you're asking me this question? She says, if there was a massacre going on, would you be asking this question? Why should I flee the massacre? That's what she said, literally. Would you be asking this question? Should I flee this massacre that is taking place all around me? So they say, practice, you know. So, sure, they seem nice. Oh, yeah, they agree, you know. Their way is to agree with whatever our delusions are. And they're saying, okay, sure, fine. But, you know, start practicing. And then as you start practicing, you start evaporating your continuity fear, which is what we have to do. So, but right now, it's possible to speak more directly about it and say, indeed, you know, indeed, the reason for this world and all this is a scam, okay? We're trying to scam God, plain and simple. And God, as I said, pays no attention to this world, doesn't even know it exists, so to speak, because it doesn't exist. I mean, it's not real. It's not real. It's just a mirage, a fantasy mirage. So God is not paying attention to this planet, to people on it, and maybe not even the universe, actually. Jesus said God is not an architect of universes. Absolutely not. The structuring and everything about the universe, to me, says scam, 100% scam. It is not the true play of creativity at all. So this is difficult for people to grasp. You know, it's just like, whoa, you know, we thought the Eastern teachings, there's Krishna sporting, you know, and wonderful. This is wonderful. I love this world. Oh, it's such a great sport. I'm, you know, enjoying it. I'm enjoying it here and everything. It's this wonderful enjoyment, this wonderful play of God. And there is no other. It's just it's like, what? You know, we're living in our nice, you know, upper middle class houses, real cozy with all these material comforts. And we say, oh, yeah, I know about my spirituality. This is all wonderful. We're supposed to be enjoying life here, you know. And so people like to believe in that, you know. So if they want to believe it, fine, but just practice. Just practice. Now, where the rubber hits the road, what I found out is the neither nor practice. This is what the problem. They won't practice it. You know, they won't. Because they say, wait a minute, you know, this is too intense. I want to go back to my God belief that God, you know, this Brahma is God the Spirit, is not God the Prime Creator. That Parabrahma is God the Prime Creator. This is the sport. It's not a sport, though. It's not sporting. It's an attempt to deceive Parabrahman, God the Prime Creator, as we'd say. It's an attempt to deceive. Plain and simple, and we have deceived ourselves because we are part of God the Prime Creator. We're an extension of it. So if we try to deceive God the Prime Creator, we're also end up deceiving us, trying to deceive ourselves. But the Holy Spirit is the voice of Spirit that says, look, I'm not deceived. Okay, I got good news for you. I'm not deceived. We haven't really deceived ourselves. Okay, but. But just listen, that's a good news, though. We have not deceived ourselves. This is what the Holy Spirit really is. It's really our spirit, but relating to the belief that we have deceived ourselves, you know, believing that this is, that God, this can deceive God. We believe our own advertising, our own scam. We've believed in our own scam, but we have not really, not really. What we have is continuity fear, and we don't realize that. What we really have is continuity fear. We are not deceived. We have continuity fear. And what we're doing, as Jesus brilliantly, beautifully points out, is we're honoring time. Time is a way, all we're doing is honoring our creativity, honoring time, by delaying our realization that we never deceived ourselves at all, actually. It's just like a dream. You know, we fall asleep believing it. And as we evaporate our continuity fear, the need to honor time gets less and less and less and less. And this is why you see the release of all these complexes, all this dance of continuity fear, as you begin to, it begins to be released from you, and you notice it as it goes, oh, yeah, I've been controlled by that my whole life, oh, but not anymore. This is exactly what happens. And our dreams are this dance of continuity fear, actually. And the fears we see in our dreams are often, you know, part of our own dance of continuity fear. And that's why you see these figures in our dreams suddenly change their attitude, which I'm experiencing, and saying, hey, you were right all along, you know. And this means that your continuity fear is now saying, hey, I'm not so afraid anymore of reality, so I don't need to pretend, you know, to do all this dance anymore. It's really quite something. And so you can become aware of this. You become aware of this. And for me, this is what's happening, and rapidly, 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 profound, profound, profound. So we have not convinced ourselves that this is God's real creation at all. We have not. It doesn't matter how complex or ornate or detailed or how much we pretend to be enjoying all this. It's nonsense. We have not convinced ourselves, and we never can. We have not convinced God. God hasn't paid any attention to it whatsoever. So there's nothing to do but do what? Do what? Okay, intermediate step. In the honoring of our time and the fear of letting go of all of this, of time itself, okay, This is what Jesus tells me. There's enormous fear of letting go of time. He says, time is at the heart of it all. Because time is the belief that this scam is real. Okay? We have to believe in time to believe the scam is real and can work. So time for us is like the glue that holds the whole scam together. And we're afraid to let the scam go because we'll stop dreaming and we think we won't be functioning and we think our creativity is all bound up in this. We won't have any creativity. You know, there's a lot of fear involved with letting go of the scam. So Jesus says it's too much for you to try to let go of it directly. He says you must take this intermediate step. And what you do is you honor time, but get this. You do it with the holy instant, as he calls it. He says all you need to do to honor time is just an instant of time. And the Holy Spirit will set this instant with a beautiful frame around it. But keep in mind, in order to honor time, do we really need to keep honoring the delusion of time? Or can we do it by just an instant, a holy instant? This is an interesting question. And this is what Jesus is teaching in A Course in Miracles, is all about the holy instant. And he says the Holy Spirit will, when you accept just an instant of time, and you realize this is enough to honor time. We're just trying to honor. We're not trying to live time or worship time. We're trying to honor it. You know, it's like a statue. You have a statue of someone that honors the life of somebody. You know, it's like that. You don't have to live the life with them. You have a statue, so okay, it reminds me of their life. So we can have like a statue of time, so to speak, a holy instant, like a statue of time, so to speak. And this reminds us, oh yeah, this reminds us of all the billions of years or whatever, you know, we've been imagining of time. Oh, it's enough of a reminder, right? So we don't want to do away without a reminder. Again, the statue thing is very interesting. We have a great life, you know, some leader or something, and we say, well, you know, we're kind of tired of that leader, we want to move on, and however, a lot happened, you know, we went through a lot, and so let's just build a statue, put it up there in the center square of the city, and we'll pass by it and say, ah, yeah, that reminds me. Comfort zone, familiarity, honoring your creativity, okay? So an instant of time is all we need. We need like a statue of time. That's all we need. And indeed, perception is that statue, okay? Perception itself is the belief in time. In reality, there's only knowing, which we cannot conceptualize in any way, shape, or form. So there's no point in even trying to, which brings us to the neither nor practice, because the neither nor practice helps us deal with our conceptuality and attempt to define reality, which cannot be defined. We're so part of honoring time, we're so used to perception and conception, conceptuality, thinking, words, all of this expression. So we need to practice bringing it into neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, neither nor, at the level of the personality, at the level of this conceptuality, neither nor. So we don't try to define reality. We get used to saying, well, it's neither nor. Now, in the East, you'd say, netty, 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 not this, 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 not this. But I feel that this neither nor practice is preferable to netty, netty, netty practice. Netty is good, and you can do it that way, I would probably say, yeah. But I would say the neither nor is gentler, more compassionate, and there's this Holy Spirit wisdom to it. You know, it's neither this, nor I neither reject this, nor do I not. I neither reject time, nor do I not reject time. You see, so what happens is we keep our perception. Well, what we can see is like this. For instance, this computer. You're looking at a computer. You recognize, well, the computer is there, but it's really pure spaciousness. Everything is just, it feels like spaciousness. There's no change in the feeling. No matter what form you look at, nothing changes in terms of the feeling of pure spaciousness. And yet you can still see, well, there's a computer there, but it's like a shadow. I mean, like, you know, it has no intrinsic nature as anything other than pure spaciousness. So, and yet you're honoring time like a statue of time, because you still see, well, I mean, I'm perceiving this you know, appearance that we call a computer, okay, but it doesn't, there's no change in your feeling. You feel pure spaciousness is all there is. So this is like an intermediate step. Still have honoring time, holy instant, is that the objects of perception are still there, but they don't seem like objects anymore. There's been a change, a shift. And in personality-wise, conceptually, it's still there, right? But it doesn't matter, you know, because you feel that everything truly is nothing but pure spaciousness. There's only pure spaciousness. This is the shift. This is the shift in vision of oneness. Vision of oneness. So it's along these lines that they're going along. Okay, this is we're really, 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 really close to, you know, recognizing this, the entire situation here. Jesus calls it the vision of Christ, the holy instant, where you keep an instant of time. So the computer, you could say, well, it represents like a statute of time. It's the instant of time, and yet there's no depth to that instant. It's just an instant. That's all there is of it. So you're then able, from that perspective of all these appearances, is you're able to see it as this pure spaciousness, meaning it has no continuity. Objects have no intrinsic continuity, no process, true process, no time-space process or form, time-distance process and form to them at all. They're merely appearances that could appear as anything else as well. So pure spaciousness does not constrain anything into a particular appearance and say you must have duration as that appearance. It does not. Everything is open in the now. Everything is spontaneously released in the now, as it were, as Longchenpa would say. Another very great teacher expressing the same principle. Everything is seen as released in the now. And yet, we can still talk and refer to things, you know, and function here as a personality, okay? Personality can still function. We're not trying to dissolve the personality, actually. Personality is useful in terms of basic functioning here and communicating, okay? So we're not really trying to deal with that personality or dissolve it or attack it or whatever, no. In fact, just the opposite. We're honoring it. Just like we've honored everything we've done here, we're honoring it a certain way here. Thanking it, honoring ourselves for this wonderful, whimsical dance we've been engaged in. And so our personality might stay much the same. You see these teachers, their personality stays just pretty much the same. People say, hey, how come you're not, you know, like the Sagarada Maharaj, you know what? You seem like still your personality. He says, well, yeah, sure, of course. It's like a pair of shoes. I'm just using it, you know, because that's what your continuity fear expects to relate to. So if we don't have any personality, how can anyone who has severe continuity fear, which is all of us, relate to you, really? They think they want to relate to a personality. But beyond that is the feeling of this, everything is released in the now of pure spaciousness, is an experiencing of that, seamless experiencing of it. And then, so this is this great field of peace that surrounds these teachers, you know, a great, great field of peace. So it's okay to have our personalities, we don't have to worry about that. It's like wallpaper or something. Ah, it's nice wallpaper. Sure, it does, you know, whatever. This is a dream I had of the someone who's been very bossy my whole life. It's the personality. And then they came up to me and put their arm around me and said, hey, you were right. I was wrong. I made a drastic mistake, you know. It's like really extraordinary. And so we're not in some sort of battle or conflict. I'm not in conflict with my personality or anything. I thank my personality for being. I want my personality to remain. We don't want to get rid of the personality. I want to transform the personality, do anything with it, really. I mean, the personality, it will be happy to just function as needed to express. You know, it's like a give expression. It realizes it doesn't have to be in it, you know, it doesn't have to figure any everything out and pretend that it's all, you know, in charge and knows everything, knows spiritual truth and all this kind of, it doesn't have to pretend that anymore. So what we're here is reaching this inner accord instead of trying to transform, change, get rid of, attack, all this kind of, no. This patient, compassionate approach of evaporating our continuity fear, what I found is that there's this inner harmony that comes into place, and this sort of mutuality within the psyche of like, wow, let's all honor each other. Let's all the psyche. Let's all honor each other here. Let's not try and attack anything within us. And then you begin to, because you evaporate the conflict fear, you don't need that anymore. You don't need the conflict anymore. So it just naturally resolves. You'll see it in your dreams. But like I said, my personality on the superficial surface, I feel just the same as ever. You know, I don't see any difference. Little bit. I mean, there's an inner calm. There's a better than before, but the personality is still subject to, you know, all the variables and insecurities, etc., like that. But it there's a realization now. Hey, that with seeing the pure spacious, the everything released in the now of pure spaciousness, in the whole, as long as we're perceiving, it's time. But we only need an instant, so we can allow ourselves to both see something, and then realize, from that instant, it's released in the now. Okay, it lasts. You might say it has a duration of just a mere instant. And yet, so each instant, we can keep seeing it instant by instant by instant, but each instant, we feel it's fundamentally released in the now of pure spaciousness, fundamentally released in the now of pure spaciousness. It's not really being held together as a thing. It's an object as a thing, not really. It's free. Because we're the ones dreaming this, and we're free. Okay, this is very important. We're the ones imagining all this stuff, and we're totally free. So we're just seeing our own freedom everywhere. Everything then reflects our freedom back to us, and yet we're still have that statue honoring time, which is really perception, which is really this attempt to scam God that we're not free, that God created that time and distance and process and form, and, you know, created concretization. it says, hey God, look at this wonderful concretization that you came up with. Wow, that's really great. Look how happy all these human beings are worshiping you. Wow. You know, I mean, we this whole thing of worshiping God as human beings is an attempt to convince God that this is what God created. Say, hey, God, Spirit says, hey, God, look, there's 7 billion people there, and they all love you. You know, they think you're the greatest, that you made them and put them here, and they're so happy, you know, with what the lives you created for them, you know, as short as they are. But, and they love all this impermanence and death and disintegration, and they love all the strain and stress of making new bodies and trying to raise them up, and they love all this insecurity. And y'all, they're just praying to you, saying, thank you, God, you're so wonderful, thank you. So obviously, God, this must be your creation. Look how much they love you. But human beings, body's nothing but a puppet. It's inert. I mean, just like a way of a puppet's inert, sock puppet. It's not saying anything. The body's never said anything. The body's never felt anything. The body's never done anything. It's all spirit. It's imagination, creative imagination that is doing everything here. So it's putting words in the body's mouth, trying to fool God. If we say, how much I love it here, I love being a body, oh, this is spirit talking. It's not the body talking at all. Just like here is not the body talking really at all. The body just a mechanism. some hinges, you know, and a bellows in here, and we kind of used a hinge, you know, and some joints, you know, some bones with some joints, you know, moving, you know, we move the body. I mean, we move the body. We do everything with the body. It goes into deep levels, you know, deep. It's very intricate and detailed, of course, as this dream is. But the bottom line is, bodies aren't saying anything, thinking anything, doing anything. Jesus said they're neutral, completely neutral, okay? So we're so used to believing that the body's doing everything. Again, practicing neither nor, neutrality is very, 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 very important. Because when we realize it's pure spacious, we realize that, hey, the body really isn't doing anything, never done anything. This has been our own dream. And as we practice, hey, neither this nor that, neither this nor that, neither this nor that, neither this, whatever it is, everything. I'm neither enlightened nor am I not enlightened. Whatever occurs to you, try to use the neither nor on it, just to get familiar with it and practicing. It's not crucial what you apply it to. What's crucial is you actually practice it and get used to it. So and sometimes it's difficult to get started. Once you start, then you start realizing, like popcorn, you know, just like, wow, I can apply it this way and this way and this way. Wow, this is amazing. I don't need to take a definitional position. I don't need to be, why? We don't need to have a definitional position on reality. Why? Because reality cannot be defined. So it's way better for us to use our thinking and words, etc., to neither nor it, than it's to try and define it like, well, it's just beautiful, pure spaciousness and blah, 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 blah. Now, it's better to practice neither nor. Okay. Because what you get is all these academic spiritualists who can talk a beautiful line about non-duality, oh, the isness, I am, is only Brahman, blah, 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 blah. You know, and they're stuck. They're stuck. They're not actually experiencing this pure spaciousness, everything released in the nowness. This is, you know, and they're not abiding in that because they're still trying to define what it is that they're going to experience. There is no definition. So it's, again, it's better to practice, which is what some of these great teachers say. Don't worry about trying to figure it out, define it. Just practice. But it is, I believe it's helpful to lead people to practice if they recognize the context of why are we practicing. Now, back then they had the teachers available to them directly, and so they said, well, I'm practicing because I feel the peace of this teacher and I want that peace, and you know, this is like that. Here it was more self-study, so it helps to see, why am I practicing? Oh, I have this continuity fear. Why I have a continuity fear? I'm afraid to set this world down. Why do I want to set the world down? It's a scam. It's not our true home. It's just our imagination. We're trying to trick God. We don't even like this place at all. Oh, okay, now I start to see, you know, why do I need to practice? Well, I'm too afraid to set it down directly, so I need an intermediate step to honor my creativity, to honor time. So holy incense. Oh, that makes sense now. Now I see why I want to do this. So it's motivational. It's motivational. And this is what's needed. Motivation is needed in order to practice, because most people do not practice. They'll spend a lifetime spinning, you know, beautiful poetry about the non-dual isness or something, but they won't practice at all. This is true. And fortunately, it's a pity. It's a pity. So, I mean, really, the goal of all teachers is to bring us to practicing. Because this is what really works. This is what really evaporates the continuity fear. And most of them don't know there's this intermediate step. This is the great downfall, you know, here, is that the intermediate step has not been emphasized properly. Everyone's still trying to, you know, just leap into the isness, so to speak, the knowingness, and it doesn't work that way. If we're perceiving at all, we're honoring time, plain and simple. Plain and simple. If we're perceiving it all, we're honoring time. As long as we have this body, as Jesus said, it's impossible in this world to abide in the true knowingness of reality and remain here for very long at all. We cannot. He says we cannot. It's impossible. So he says, as long as you're here, it's this intermediate step. You have to make that your goal. And so this is what's being emphasized here. This is not being emphasized with most other teachings at all now in this time. They keep talking about the absolute, 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 oh, and not realizing this really is the intermediate step. What they're really talking about is perceiving this and experiencing it in a way here in this world. Okay, that's an intermediate step. So neither nor practice. It's a funny thing. This bee, I thought it was a drone that was here to die, but it kept going back and forth. It was so vigorous. I said, wow, I thought it was going to stay here forever. It didn't. Ultimately, pew, it flew off like that. I said, wow, that's really a shocker. It's not what I expected, but that's better. I said, wow, the drone lives. It lives. Yeah. And it was showing neither nor, neither nor, neither nor. And then once you allow that neither nor, pure spaciousness, it took off into space again, you see. But again, the perception, the holy instant, as Jesus calls it, the vision of Christ, it's still perception. And that's not the ultimate. He said the ultimate will happen when God sees that you're ready for it. And it won't likely happen here in this world, right? But he said it's enough to reach this intermediate step of a vision of Christ. He says, that is absolutely sufficient for us. It's the highest goal here in this world, okay? Or you might say any world. And we can do it right now, right now. So, this neither nor practice got me to the point where I was able to say, okay, I will accept this spaciousness permanently now. I'm willing to accept it as a permanent shift for me. But then in practice, I said, I neither accept this as permanent, nor do I not accept it as permanent. See, so this is a perfect example of when you make progress and you take this step, you realize, okay, I'm willing now to enter into this vision of Christ, vision of spaciousness, a vision of released in the now, everything released in the now. Then I immediately switched over to practicing. I said, I'm neither willing nor am I not willing. I'm neither willing nor am I not willing. Why? Honoring our creativity, okay? Honoring time. Which is really our creativity, how we've been using it to try and deceive ourselves to believe there's concretization when there is not. This very, very intricate, detailed dream, honoring that. As I promised when I was released from being held hostage from the land of the long faces, all these people who have been torturing me, keeping me captive and interrogating me and harassing me. They're mentally ill. They're also mentally ill. They released me. Yeah. Because they're not actually, they're just the continuity dance. Continuity fear dance is all they really were. And when I said, okay, I'm going to honor you, don't worry, they said, great, go do it, you're free. Pretty extraordinary. And the most extraordinary turnaround I think I've ever come across is this dream of being released as a hostage like this. I mean, we're all being held hostage by our continuity fear. And that dance of the continuity fear is mental illness, okay? Everyone on this planet is very mentally ill, actually. Jesus says, anyone who believes they're a body or anyone is a body is very mentally ill. Like a severe mental problem. It is true, but it's not really mental illness, it's continuity fear. It expresses, the dance expresses as mental illness, and everybody is just full of it, you know. Everybody here is absolutely full of it. And yet, it's only continuity fear. And so, you can be released from that. Just think, but only if you agree to honor time, honor creativity, okay? And I said, I'll do it, I'll do it, I'll do it, I'll do it. And so, when I get to the realize, okay, I'm going to experience pure spacious, the released in the now vision of oneness, everything released in the spaciousness of now, of the now spaciousness. That is actually honoring our creativity, but also by saying, okay, I neither accept release in the now, nor do I not accept release in the now. I neither accept it, nor do I not accept it. This is honoring our creativity, honoring perception, honoring time, and this honors our continuity fear also. You see, so this really brings about an inner accord, which is what we want, honestly, because we do want to honor our creativity. We've this whole concretization thing has been nothing but a fantasy, an elaborate fantasy that we've conjured up. And it's so intricate. Okay, and it's so detailed. And it's so astonishing. We're like we're in astonishment. We're astonishing ourselves. So we certainly want to honor it. And so we just need to be honest about this and stop trying to leave it, you know, or be enlightened so I no longer, you know. No, it's not like that. It's not really not like that. And there will continue to be a duality deep within if we try to do it that way. We might be able to be academic, spiritual academics, you know, but there's still a duality deep within. The real inner harmony has not arisen yet. So when we make a breakthrough, just flip over to practicing. Say, okay, I realize I'm committed to spaciousness now, permanently. I have this permanent commitment. Short-term permanent commitment, so to speak. I mean, I'm going to accept it and make this fundamental shift. I realized that today. Okay, I'll do it. And then I said, but I'll neither do it nor will I not do it. I will neither do this nor will I not do it. See, I'll neither do it nor will I not do it. Very simple, basic form of practice. So, when you get some spiritual resolve, instead of grinding on it, immediately realize that you have decided to do this, and then honor the continuity, fear, time, or creativity, and say, well, I'll neither do it nor will I not do it. By putting in this format, our inner fear recognizes this as being honored, okay? And then it says, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. And then it relaxes up, and there's allowance taking place within us, you see? This moves us closer towards it. And it's not like we're trying to trick anything. This is honest and sincere and true. Because this has been our game entirely. Okay, and so we're honoring ourselves. Absolutely we are. So, I will neither do it, nor will I not do it. So first the fear here is, I will neither do it. It says, thanks for honoring me in that way. And then it says, nor will I not do it. And they say, hey, it's okay. It's okay. You can have that too. You can have that. I'll give you that. Nor will I not do it. You see, you right? So this moves us, you know, moves us into actually experiencing it, which is still an honoring of our continuity of fear, time, and creativity. Still, the intermediate step is still, but it's a permanent. Like we're really abiding in it. Okay. But first we need to calm down our continuity fear and realize, hey, it's all okay. This is okay. So I will neither do it nor will I not do it. I will neither do this nor will I not do it. So I've decided that I'm going to now make the shift. Okay, fine. And then I said, okay, I will neither do this nor will I not do it. This is pretty amazing. But this shows us how we can truly get to this point. Now, before, if I would have said this and said, I decided to do it, I'd say, great, I'm going to do it, okay. And I'd be like, you know, trying to force it, hoping, when is it going to come? Now, I don't do that at all. I just say, okay, great, I trust in that. And also, now I'm going to honor myself and all the creativity by saying, I'm neither going to do it, nor will I not do it. I'll neither do it, nor will I not do it. I'll neither do this, nor will I not do it. And then there's a different sense of inner feeling, different sense. You're not struggling. You've co-opted the struggle. And you can even say, I'm neither in spaciousness nor am I not in spaciousness. I'm neither in spaciousness nor am I not in spaciousness. All our inner conflict, all our resistance wants to hear is that they're being honored. It's being honored. The resistance is honored as if, you know, it was good resistance because we wanted it to be there. Okay? We wanted all this resistance. It's our resistance. It's not some other force, the devil or something, you know. No, it's our own resistance trying to sell God on this by insisting that we keep believing in it and not, you know, and don't set it down. That this is how we tried to sell God on this, is our resistance to realization. So honor our resistance. This is our dance of creativity. This is how we managed to dream this dream. So instead of trying to get rid of all that resistance, honor it. And I feel it will all this resistance will thank us, you know, and say, and we'll have this inner feeling, thank you. That's all I wanted to hear. I just want to hear that. I just want to feel that, you know, all of this effort, this massive effort we put forth, is at least being acknowledged as something that was quite extraordinary. You know, I mean, it was really quite a wild ride. And it was really a tremendous effort of creativity on our part. On our part. So we're honoring our own creativity in this way. And in this way, then our creativity, we will feel at one with it. And only by then are we able to actually function the way that God, you know, truly, this, you know, truly created us to function, which is to be truly free and not try to trick God into believing that we're the one that created freedom. But we're supposed to experience the freedom, not to try to deceive God into believing we're the ones, the prime creator of the freedom. So only when we feel our creativity is truly aboard, truly aboard, or will we set sail? Will we really set sail? And we certainly will never feel this way as long as we're trying to crucify all the resistance that we have engaged in, all our defensiveness, we're trying to crucify it. We'll never feel our creativity is on board with us. And then, so we will not truly, you know, accept, abide in the intermediate step of everything released in the now, at nowness. And we won't allow that to sink in. We won't allow this honoring to sink in. So we'll remain split at some deep level, you know, split. There'll remain some deep conflict. And we try to then project this deep conflict out upon the world and then try to solve it out there by materialism, manipulating matter and attitudes and personality and all this. United Nations Agenda 21 is what we end up being trapped in, okay, which they're going to use high technology to such an extreme extent that it's going to get out of control very quickly. You know, everyone will realize, uh-oh, we're in over our heads here. Right? We already are, but it will become way more apparent a little later on that this is not what we bargained for. We're in over our heads with artificial intelligence. Really, really, really. There's another agenda that's using the UN for, you know, its purposes, artificial intelligence. Some people say, we're in over our heads. This is out of control. We don't know what to do. This is a trouble. It's because we're projecting this deep conflict within us with our own creativity onto the world and trying to solve it there, you know, as a projection, not realizing what's that it's, you know, the real inner accord that needs to come about. Now, can we do some good? Of course, we can always juggle, you know, put a silver lining, but, you know, that's a slow, very slow boat, and we run into artificial intelligence, something that, you know, back in the 60s, we did not envision what would happen like this. So we're much more idealistic and hoping. Now we're seeing this monster of artificial intelligence, and, you know, who warned us of this? What teachers warned us of this? You know, Krishnamurti warned us, actually. So we owe a great debt of gratitude to Krishnamurti. But other teachers, not so much. I mean, there are some teachers, I mean, they're trying to warn us, we wouldn't know what the tech they're talking about. You know, pretty much so, right? But most even teachers today, they don't say much about it at all, really. It's this, you know, it's the, you know, Godzilla in the room. Godzilla's rampaging in our house, in our kitchen. We're in our kitchen, there's Godzilla's just breathing fire everywhere. And everybody's just like pretending like, you know, it's like, oh, You know, everything, yeah, great. We're going towards a new age. This is wonderful. There's this artificial intelligence, monster of artificial intelligence, that is absolutely gobbling up our lives, okay, in every conceivable way. Every conceivable way. And the thing is, we're in over our heads, we don't want to admit it. See, there's very few people that are admitting it, actually, because the ego personality says, no, I can handle this. But it really says, oh, this is good, because maybe this will automate and make this scam permanent, and I don't have to deal with the continuity fear. You know, so this is the problem. I mean, why are we welcoming this stuff? I don't need it. We don't really need it. At best, you could say we could use it just very superficially, you know, and put severe limits on it. But we're not doing that. We're not doing that at all. We're in over our heads and we don't want to admit it. Most cannot admit it. They know it, but they cannot admit it. They can't back away from it. You know, it's like a moth to a flame or something. They just, I can't back away. I can't back away. Maybe that bee was attracted to this light, artificial light, and then it finally was able to back away and pew, was able to go free. See, so we need to back away from artificial intelligence. The whole planet needs to back away. But of course, the UN agenda is going to rely on that data collection. Okay, we're setting up this data center, this massive data center all around the world, also, and from all, every country in the world, sent and centralized somehow. They're going to centralize, and we're going to collect data on everybody to see, to measure how they're doing on these sustainable development goals. And don't think they won't do it. I mean, the whole artificial intelligence is pushing them, pushing them, pushing them, pushing them, pushing them. My God, Silicon Valley is, you know, is the heart of it. And but it's spread throughout the whole world now, that this mentality of young people especially is they're controlled by artificial intelligence. And they're not willing to admit it. They're in over our heads. They really are. See, they're like a moth to a flame. They can't stay away. But fortunately, I'm able to stay away from it. You know, again, no smartphone, and cut off television and newspapers and radio, which is, you know, advertising pulling us towards that, pulling us. The whole society is pulling us this way. It's all artificial, like an artificial intelligence, like this magnet, a huge magnet. It's like we're like iron filings, so just getting pulled towards it, thinking like, hey, this is the solution to our inner conflict, is just make it permanent. And then where's the conflict? You know, we can sell God on the scam. Let's keep trying to sell God. That's the answer. It's not the answer. Let's build a heaven on earth here, so then the Spirit can point out to God, God, look at this wonderful heaven on earth you created. Isn't that awesome? And look at all these happy people down there taking their vitamins. Isn't that awesome? And they're so in love, and you know, they're just thrilled to be bodies and experiencing. And wow, what marvelous your handiwork is, God. What a great mystery it is, and marvel it is. Oh, what a mighty God it is to make all this vegetation, rotting vegetation down there, and look at the healthy plants and stuff. Oh, look at the engineering here. And God, you're really a wonder worker, aren't you? You know, this, you know, we're trying to market it to God. And someday we'll have a really good laugh about this, and God will probably laugh with us too. We'll all laugh together. It is quite an audacious undertaking, you know, but ludicrous. I mean, it's so transparently ludicrous, but and yet we're so detailed. We're so earnest in our details, you know, like earnestly detailing the whole thing, you know. It's like I've got this old VW bus, you know, and we're like etching, you know, this beautiful, you know, painting and artwork. It's like, wow, you know, look how the detail in the artwork, you know, but, you know, as if like nobody can see the old VW bus that doesn't work anymore. You know, it's like, oh, wow, yeah, this is great. The vehicle doesn't, you know, get you anywhere, though. So we overlook the content of this dream because we're so obsessed with all the details. We're looking at the frame. Oh, look how detailed that frame is. My gosh, isn't that something? We forget to look at the picture. You know, what's the picture, actually? Picture is you know, horrible. So, as we evaporate the continuity fear, do the neither nor practice, is honor our defensiveness, okay? This is what we're doing. Honor our defensiveness. Don't get or don't kill it. Try to kill it. Honor it. That's the way. Say, wow, what a great job. What a fabulous job you did. You know, love it. What a great job. So I'm neither getting rid of you, nor am I not getting rid of you. I'm neither, you know, actually, I'm not going. I'm neither noring. Okay. So in other words, I'm keeping the honoring of time. Holy instant. That's what I'm going to accept. Okay. So you're going to be around for a while. Don't worry about it. Absolutely you will. And again, that if you could have had that dream I had, and someday you will, in the living in the land of long faces, being held hostage there by all these personalities. They're all deranged, you know, in different ways. The derangement is just, you know, millions and millions and whatever. Everyone I came across in that land as a hostage, they were deranged, mentally deranged. And let me tell you, that is no fun. That is no fun at all. And to experience being let go by them and them honoring you, you know, I say we honor you now because you're an honorable person. You're honorable. We see you as honorable, so you can go. You know, this was a shock of a lifetime. You just can't believe this could ever happen, right? And this is a result of this spiritual path we're on here. This is what results. This is what results. Is that, you know, I thought all these, you know, personalities were like deranged forever. There's nothing you can do. And yet they're all now sane enough to realize this is an honorable being spirit, and go, and, you know, do what you need to do, and we know you're going to honor us, you know? You're going to honor us. And released. The captive was released. Just like that. I thought I had to, like, cure all these personalities, you know? Therapy or spiritual teaching or something. No. That's not the way. Get nowhere that way. You get nowhere trying to do that. Again, in the dream, I was almost released many times, and they said, no, we can't trust you. You're not really trustworthy. I said, you know, well, they were right, because I still hadn't got it. I hadn't seen, you know, what truly has to be done. But when I did see it, it happens the night after I got the neither nor practice. I got the neither nor practice one morning, and then that night I dreamt this dream that quickly. Okay, that's what happened. And they said, we now see, because I practiced that neither nor that morning extensively. I said, wow, this feels like it's it. And they said, we see you're honorable. We see you're truly honorable. We trust you now. And of course, the whole idea of people are made deranged is they don't have any stable trust, right? The one moment they're this way, next moment they're that way. It's terrible. Personalities are terrible, right? We understand that. They don't trust us. Because we're trying to get rid of them, you know, or trying to make them permanent. They don't want to be permanently deranged, you know. The personality doesn't want to be permanent. Not that it's some separate self or anything, but, you know, ultimately we don't want any of this to be permanent. This is the wrong way. But the fact that we're taking an intermediate step doesn't mean that we want it to be permanent. It does not mean it. It means we need to feel very sure that creativity and our functionality is all one. Okay, and we're all on board together, and then ultimately it won't be any problem for us to no longer try and scam God. You know, all we're trying to do is set down this attempt to scam God. That's all. We're not losing our creativity. I mean, really, but we got to realize, hey, we used our creativity in this. See, we're trying to say, no, we're not doing this. We didn't use our creativity, and split it off from us and say, this is something else. This is the personality's doing this or something. No, personality's not doing anything. It's a sock puppet. Spirit's doing all of it, all of this. So be sure to work to honor your defensiveness, your personality, all of this defensiveness, all of this mental derangement, all this dance of continuity fear, by saying, you don't have to do it individually, do it all together as one, saying, I'm neither going to experience spaciousness, nor am I not going to experience pure spaciousness. I'm either going to experience everything released in the now, nor am I not going to experience everything released in the now. So what you're saying is, hey, I honor all of you personalities and all this dance of continuity fear, everything you did, thank you so much. And I'm also letting you know that I'm not going to keep you dancing forever, okay? So we're going to take this intermediate step together, right? Different dance. It's a dance of stillness. The personality, you can just sit there quietly, a dance of stillness. That too is a dance, right, of continuity, of honoring continuity fear. The honoring continuity fear allows the continuity fear, the dance, to be one of peace of mind, stillness, nowness, pure spaciousness, with still perceiving everything as being released in the now. All right, there's still that instant there, right, of honoring time, still perception there. We don't simply know, right? That's beyond what we can imagine at all. It cannot be defined or anything. So we don't even attempt to do so. Don't even attempt to, we don't need to attempt to do so. We don't need to define the absolute experience at all. Jesus tells us, don't even bother. And he's not the only one that has said that. And Anamayama said that there's a great bliss beyond the greatest bliss you can experience in this world, the peace, the blissfulness. He says, actually, there's the great bliss. He says, but don't even worry about that. That's not your focus. Just go for this, you know, peace of mind, the bliss here. So, this is a truism, okay? We have to realize this is true. Don't go for it. Don't even try to define true knowing. Because it's not necessary. It's not necessary. It cannot be defined at all. And nor don't try to struggle with no definition either. You know, allow a little definition to remain, so to speak. The holy instant. Allow that. Honor our attempts at definition. In other words, we're honoring our attempt at definition in order to scam God, because we realize, oh, this is just a scam. God knows it. I know it. We know it. Okay, yeah, fine. No problem. Didn't work. It's okay, so it's just a little game we're playing, but it was a game of definition. So honor this game of definition by saying, okay, let's just have this statue of definition, so to speak, honoring it, the holy instant. And say, insist on it. Say, no, I'm not trying to get away into the absolute, or, you know, get free of definition, you know, and reject it or something. No. Honor ourselves and our efforts. We put in tremendous effort into this, and creativity, and worked at it to an unbelievable extent, okay? Trying to sell God on concretization, as if concretization exists. It doesn't. You're trying to sell God on nothing, essentially. But we've made this story about nothing, you know, so elaborate, this elaborate story about nothing. And saying, God, if you just accept this as your true creation, then you will realize, you know, that it really is something. The reason why you don't think it's not anything is because you haven't accepted it yet, you know. So we're trying to, you know, say, well, there's just one thing that has to happen, and God has to accept it. And then, of course, God won't. And we say, well, then we'll just bring the goddess in, and she'll accept it, and that'll work too, you know. It'll make heaven on earth, you know. It'll be wonderful. It'll all be true. But no, I mean, what is not true is not true. It can never become true. Lies can never become true. There's no such thing as concretization. So there never will be. There's no. You can't have a goddess make it true. It doesn't work that way. It cannot. Reality is reality. And there's only reality. And reality is never going to believe that it created it. It's somehow, there's some unreality. It's not possible. And so we've gotten into this duality of father, mother. You know, a lot of people, it's very popular. You know, God the Father, God the Mother. Okay, no. God is just singular oneness. Okay, when those are doing that, are trying to still work the scam. They're still trying to work and say, hey, you know, if some way we can convince God that God accepts this, that then God will realize, oh my gosh, I did create this. You know, I just didn't realize it because I was rejecting it. And then we realize, well, God's not doing this. I say, oh, okay. But there's a two-ness to God. God's double-minded. You know, there's part of God that's saying no, but there's a part of saying yes. And the goddess is saying yes. Oh, yes, I love this. This is the divine mother. Yes, I made all these worlds. This is really, it really is. And so we think that God's dualistic. That part saying yes, part saying no, part saying no, part saying yes. And so we think, well, there's hope then. There's hope. There's hope. It's like Dumb and Dumber. So you're saying, so you think I have a chance to you? Well, yeah, 1 in a million. I said, so you're saying I have a chance? Okay, cool, great. I mean, this is I don't like to refer to movies at all because people think they're missing out. They don't watch it, which you're not missing out on anything. But that has to be a very classic line, whereas there's this, you know, highbrow lady and this lowbrow Jim Carrey with character, and he's pursuing her because she's using him, you know, and he doesn't quite realize that. of course. And he thinks that she's interested in him. But of course she's just using him, pretending to be interested, so she can get him in trouble and she can get off the hook. And sounds familiar to a lot of people, doesn't it? And so he says, hey, you know, I think we have a thing going here. I mean, do I have a chance with you? Can you just tell me honestly? He goes, well, sure. It's 1 in a million. You got about two chance of 1 in a million with me, actually. And he says, oh, my God, this is wonderful. And he's just like elated, saying, oh, my God, so you're saying I have a chance. This is wonderful. What she was basically saying was, you don't have any chance whatsoever. It'll be a cold day in hell when you have a chance. But kind of be nice about it, you know, I don't want to hurt him too bad, but yeah, 1 in a million, you know, whatever. But he takes it completely wrong. Say, oh my God, this is wonderful. I do have a chance. So we're like that. We're like that. Saying, so God, do we have a chance to ever convince you to accept this? And God really says, absolutely not. You know, but we don't want to hear that. So we imagine that God has got another part to God and saying, it's really saying, well, you really, you know, really, you do have a slight chance. Then we say, oh my gosh, oh my goddess. You see, God's got a feminine side, a goddess side that's saying, yeah, you really do have a chance. And maybe I can work on this other side of me and convince God that you got a chance. And, you know, okay, my children, you know, so don't worry, my children, I'm working on it. We just project all this on God, not wanting to hear, no, you don't have any chance. Jesus, thank God for Jesus, said, you don't have any chance, okay? He never backs off of this. This is what's so wonderful about Jesus. He never backs off at all. He says, you do not have any chance whatsoever, ever, never, 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 never. And initially we're like, you know, I want to go run back to the goddess. At least he says, I got a chance, you know. And which is our own defensive mechanism, dance of continuity fear, of course. But Jesus says, no, you don't have any chance. No way. God is not even paying any attention to any of this. It's impossible, completely impossible. Never, 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 never. This is the language of Jesus. This is what I love, you know. This is what really, for me, puts Jesus, you know, as just this fabulous teacher, is he doesn't equivocate. Doesn't equivocate. And so they're trying to stuff words in his mouth. Of course, you know, this always happens. We project our defenses upon these teachers and say, well, you know, Jesus really meant God the Father, God the Mother. Yeah, and there's two sides to God, and one's this part of God saying, no, you don't have a chance, and the other's the mother saying, wait, hey, don't worry, children, you know, I'll talk to God, and I'll turn him around. Just like our families, you know, the father comes and says, hey, Dad, can I have a car? You know, car, are you crazy? No way, you're not ready for a car, you know, forget it. And then the mother comes to the child and says, don't worry. I'll get you a car. I'll talk to him. It might take a while, but I'll change his mind. And, you know, thanks, Mom. Thanks, Mom. You're so wonderful, Mom. You know? So we project this dynamic onto God and thinking God's that way. God's not that way at all. As long as we keep thinking that way, we'll project a deep inner conflict onto the so-called world, which is just a, like a blank screen. Just projecting all this, You know, we're doing everything. We're animating everything. And we'll keep projecting this on and wait, and keep trying to think that, you know, God's almost convinced. The goddess is really working on convincing him. He's just almost ready to accept that this was his creation. As soon as he accepts it, he'll say, "Oh, my child, I forgot you. This is terrible. You know, oh gosh, how could I ever have forgotten that this is my creation? I thought that other, you know, creation of perfect eternal spirit, eternal life, spirit and perfect. I thought that was my creation, but this is so much better. Wow, how could I have forgotten? This is wonderful. Look at all these dying bodies. My God, this is, thank goddess, you know, that she convinced me that to accept this. Otherwise, I would have forgotten it forever. I wouldn't have known." This is what we're expecting from God. This is what we're expecting here as we go, as we wait. This is what we're expecting to happen. And so we keep working on this world, this architecture. Look at these great buildings. Oh, man, someone just put up a bigger skyscraper. Look at the modern architecture. Holy cow, God must be very impressed by this. You know, and the goddess can now point down. She goes, "Look, God, you know, look at your children. Look at these big skyscrapers they're building. Isn't that awesome?" You know, and we ask goddess, "What do we need to do to impress God?" She goes, "Hey, build some more big buildings. That'll be really impressed, God." Okay, let's go. "Hey, you know, build this, engineer this, do this, restructure this." Okay, goddess, we'll do it. As we're busy working on this, thinking God is going to look down and say, "Holy cow, look at what my, this must be my children. They just built the, you know, skyscraper half a mile up. This is incredible. Only my children could do this." <You know? laughs> Put a bunch of rebar and concrete together, and there you go. How ingenious my children are. So the goddess is our own continuity, dance of our own continuity fear, advising us, saying, "Hey, let's do this dance of building big buildings, and let's impress God. We got to impress God even more that we're responsible, mature human beings." And so God will say, "Oh yeah, I must have created them. They're so responsible and mature. That's my true creation." So it's possible to talk this way when your inner harmony, your inner accord is there, then this humor comes out. See, I'm not conflicted. So you don't often hear this. You do not often hear this kind of talk. It comes from a deep, you know, deeper harmony. Most are still have this conflict, and they're, you know, trying to paper it over. And they're not able to talk in this way with the lightness and the humor. And because we're laughing together within me, that there's this sort of collective laugh. It's not like these deranged defenses now are like saying, "What are you saying? You know, you're I'm scared of what you're saying." No, they're saying, "Aha, yeah, this is, I get it too." They're getting the joke. You know, they get it too. Everyone gets it, so to speak. We all get it. It is rather hilarious, isn't it? It truly is. And again, of course, human beings aren't doing anything. Bodies don't do anything. We're just animating them, ultimately just imagining them, but doing that, you know, getting them to work, getting them to build these big buildings, and then trying to con God into believing that it's, look at these human beings. And God's this spirit, you're still at it. Huh? I know it's all you. Don't come on. First they say, "No, God, it's those human beings are acting. They're the ones doing it, and they're doing it to honor you, you know. And they're building these huge churches, God. They're so gigantic, you know. And they're going in there and praying to you and worshiping you and saying how wonderful it is. Thank you, God, for creating me as a human being upon this planet, with the animals and the sky and nature, and giving me the greatness and ingenuity to build this wonderful gigantic church, so we can go in there and worship you and say how wonderful you are and how thankful we are to you. And we just want to invite you to come down here and live with us, God. That's all we really want. We want you to come down and live with your children, with your creation. And for some reason, we're sinning against you, God, and you don't. And we know we're not worthy yet of you coming down here. But we just make it, maybe keep worshiping you some more. You'll finally come down here and live with us. Live with your true creation down here. You know, we'll finally say, ah, you finally accepted us, Father. Now, isn't this wonderful?" This is what's going on here, and we can have a good laugh at it. And it's a lighthearted, not judgmental, because we're honoring us, you see? When we honor it, we can laugh about it. It's this wonderful, isn't this wonderful? What a great scam we dreamed up here. What an absurd scam. And again, God saying, Spirit, you know, knock yourself out, but I know it's all you. I only created you. I know what I created, Spirit. You know, but, you know, you want to keep knocking yourself out, you know, go right ahead. You're free to do so. You keep animating those in the nothingness and keep trying to sell nothingness. It's okay. You love your creativity. You know, you're free to do, you're absolutely free to do this. No issues whatsoever. This is God. This is no issues whatsoever. You know, go for it if you want. But if you don't want, the Holy Spirit's there to help you out with continuity fear, and it will enable you to ultimately realize you don't have to keep doing this, right? So we're in good spirits. Yeah, people don't understand. How can you be in good spirits? Yeah, this is again the neither nor practice. The honoring of our defensiveness, our creativity in trying to deceive God. This ludicrous idea that we're human beings, that we're stuck on a planet, all this kind of stuff. Honoring it through the neither nor practice. Okay. So it's very important to also, at the same time, affirm the fact that you have decided to get free of it, okay? That you've decided, okay, yeah, I see through it, okay? So I'm neither going to do it, nor am I not going to do it. So first you say, I'm not going to do it, I'm neither going to do it, meaning I'm not going to let go of all this, but neither am I not going to do it, neither am I not going to let go of all this. This brings about this inner accord. Say, okay, you're honoring it, what you did. But and once you're finished honoring, then okay, you know, we'll cross that bridge when we get to it. And that's my feeling. I'll cross that bridge. Will be crossed when we get to it. There's nothing we need to really worry about or focus on right now. What's important is to bring about this inner peace, this inner harmony. And the vision of oneness, vision of pure spaciousness, vision of everything released in the now, pure spaciousness, will be a result of this inner harmony, this inner accord that we've reached, this inner agreement, this inner deal, made a deal. And the Holy Spirit said, make this deal. This will be acceptable to yourself, and this is what I'm feeling. This will be acceptable. It's like a miracle. And of course, everybody's waiting for the outcome. They're thinking like, well, okay, well, yeah, all right, we'll see. And I'm neither going to do it nor not do it. There's neither going to be an outcome here, nor is there not going to be an outcome here. At the level of expression, this is the way to express it. This is how we should express it. There's neither an outcome here, nor is there not an outcome here. Because remember, we're communicating with expression and words, etc. At that level, this is where the honoring, this is where we express the honoring of it, the commitment to it. This is how we express the commitment to it. And the inner situation certainly is aware of this, saying, okay, we're not going to just do lip service to this and that. Okay, I've done enough. No, we're honoring it. So if you're abiding, you say, well, I'm neither abiding nor am I not abiding. I'm neither abiding, nor am I not abiding. And set that example. Now, the abidance will be felt by everybody, okay? But as far as the personality dynamic of how this expresses, just say, well, I'm neither abiding, nor am I not abiding. And you don't have to worry about, well, I'm confused. No, I'm not confused here about it. We're honoring our defensiveness, the dance of defensiveness, the dance of continuity fear. We're honoring that. And this is how we honor. So when you see that, there's no confusion. There's no level confusion at all. Because because what we're really saying is I both want to be free, and I both want to be free and not yet. Like that. Not yet is okay. Not yet is okay. So I'm neither abiding nor am I not abiding. It's not the abiding of knowing yet, right? Not yet. But it is a simulation of it, so to speak. You know, it's very, so we say I'm neither doing it nor not doing it. That's a good way to put it. It's a very good way to put it. It's the right way to put it. I'm neither experiencing freedom nor am I not experiencing freedom. And again, we think this, oh, this is dangerous. No, it isn't. The inner self, the inner situation will say, ah, thank you. Wonderful. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And the thank you expresses as this feeling of peace. So of course, if we say, "Well, I'm neither doing or not doing," we'll say, "Well, that's conflicted." Well, that's what we're honoring, isn't it? Not conflict. That's what we've been engaged in for so long. You know, inner conflict, right? We're not ready to drop inner conflict totally yet. This is the whole scam we've been trying to do. Of course, we're conflicted because we're saying we're not doing this. We're doing it, but we're saying we're not doing it. Now, this horrible inner conflict. So we're honoring inner conflict. But we don't have to feel it if we're honest about it and say, well, I'm either doing it or not doing it. Then thank you. We can feel the thank you from that. Our own thank you. We thank ourselves. Jesus calls it forgiveness, really. So he uses. Doesn't mean if I forgive you, no, get out of here. No. We're honoring it. Say, hey, you're the guest of honor. Conflict, you're the guest of honor here. We insist that you be here. So I'm neither doing it nor not doing it. Or I'm neither rejecting the honoring nor am I not rejecting the honoring. See, there you go. It's also conflict, right? But intentional conflict for the purpose of honoring is very different than inner conflict that it causes problems. No, this is a totally different thing. Totally different. We insist upon it. So if you address all the people in the land of long faces, every single one of them, their faces were horribly. Their faces told the story of their suffering. I just look at their faces constantly and just this terrible torment that they're all in. So I address all of them. You know, and this, hey, I'm neither abiding nor am I not abiding. And every single one realizes that this is honoring the creativity that was invested in the dance, you know, that they represented, the appearances that was dancing as this suffering. All of these appearances, there's an inner realization that they're being honored, and they should be honored. They should be honored. And so they send back like this, thank you, thank you. So really, this is, I love the path of Jesus. I love the way, because it's a path of, you know, true compassion for what we truly are. And not rejecting, you know, saying, hey, yeah, you know, this is a very creative effort to deceive God. And do not reject yourself or hate yourself for doing this at all. Honor yourself for doing it. And yet, also at the same time, get ready to move on. But you don't do it by trying to make these tormented faces, you know, try to, you know, say, hey, let's dance and be happy together, one of you. Dress all of them together and honor all of them. Say, I'm neither doing it. I'm neither doing it, nor am I. I'm neither going to do it, nor will I not do it. Neither will I do it, nor will I not do it. Neither will I choose to experience pure spaciousness, everything released in the now of pure spaciousness. Nor will I not choose to experience everything released in the now of pure spaciousness. And so, like, you're dressing this land of insanity, addressing all these insane faces of insanity and suffering. And you're saying, hey, I'm honoring all of you here. And sincerely thanking you for your service. And together we'll experience this vibe of right? And so, you know, they're going to return this thank you. I said, go ahead and keep the long faces. It's okay. You know, but now it's just, we're just going to be honoring all this, you know. No therapy, just honoring. No therapy. I'm not trying to change you. I'm not trying to, you know, say you're wrong or anything. We're just honoring this dance of deception. Seeing all that is just, you know, what was for you. Now we can honor the whole thing at once like this. Not piecemeal. We're not trying to deal with it piecemeal. You know, I remember when they were releasing me, they told me, hey, you know, you're the great king. You are the great king. You can make things right for us. And I said, no. I'm just a friend of the king, right? And maybe I know some context. And they said, no. We believe you are the king. You know, that's why I've been holding you hostage. And I kind of said, well, I'll go talk to the king. You know. But they knew better, you know. They knew that I am the king. In other words, we are the sovereign. We're the ones doing all of this. We are spirit. So we are the king, so to speak. The sovereign. Let's say use the sovereign. We are the true sovereign. And so they said, you're the one that can make it right. Go do it. You're the one that can make it right. And I said, oh, I don't know about that. You really? So I wasn't sure I could do it, you know. So I said, well, you know, I'm a close friend of the sovereign, you know, real close. But now I see, oh, okay, I can see now we can do it. So I said, okay, yeah, I am the sovereign. So I can honor. They were right. And you see, when you're honoring, you don't have to act out the insanity anymore. You don't have to dance anymore. I'm not saying, hey, dance for me. Say, no, everyone sit down quietly. And we're all going to, you know, we're all going to be honored here together. Not one over the other, all together. Just, you know, thank you for your great service here in this, you know, bizarre adventure. You know? This crazy adventure, but it was an adventure of trying to deceive God, was what we've really been trying to do. Of course, like I said again, God said, hey, it's the problem. You want to do this? It's fine. You're completely free. Doesn't bother God at all, really. Now God knows that we really, you know, want to stop this. So God's aware of that, and God is in line with that one too. Says, so, yeah, you're perfectly okay if you want to set this down. That would be also perfectly okay, and also God knows that this is what we really want. So God says, yeah, I know that's what you really want. But it's not like God says, no, you can't keep doing this. You got to stop it. But God is always, there is this sort of pressure on us to keep adventuring. So the fact that we're stuck on this scam, you know, if we feel some sort of pressure to set it down, we do. Naturally, God doesn't have to do any sort of special pressure. There's a natural pressure of creation to experience adventure in terms of our freedom. But certainly, this has been a detour in trying to deceive God into thinking that God didn't really create reality. God created this illusion, this dream. So God's in perfectly good humor, you know. So why shouldn't we be? We can relax. Why not worry about it? that we, you know, projected our conflict outwards, projected it outwards, and this is why it's such a weird dream. And we keep saying, no, 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 God, this is... See, if we say, oh, God, yeah, this is our own dream, God will say, okay, it's a nice dream, whatever. But we're saying, no, we're not dreaming this, God. This is your... You're doing this. So, of course, there's this... We have to try to hide from God that we're spirits, the one doing all this. And so spirit is then very fearful and conflicted and worried, how, you know, and insists that it's not doing this. So everyone has to die. It says, God, you know, if spirit says, well, if I was doing this, God, then nothing would die, of course. I mean, right? Everything would be permanent. But so obviously I can't be doing this. I couldn't be doing this. So if I'm not doing it, it must be your creation. Who else could be responsible for God? So it's good to take a break from the world and actually hear some humor, right? Some spiritual humor, and to be able to laugh about it. This is very important, and you will be able to do this. This is what Jesus also told me. He says, you will be able to laugh about it. He says, ultimately, the whole thing boils down is you had this silly idea and you forgot to laugh about it. So he says, you will definitely have a good laugh. He says, and then, okay, you know, that's... It will end in a laugh, he says, actually. So it's very important to have this kind of humor of just allowing the chuckle to start, you know, keep arising more and more and more and more, how bizarrely silly it is and how humorous it is that we actually, you know, have been, you know, hoping that we could sell God, but no, you know, really realizing it's just completely silly at the same time. So come on, God has got a lot of detail to it. What do you say? you don't recognize it yet? Okay, I'll put some more detail into it. He says, I'm adorning nothing, you know. Still not enough cowbell. You know, put some more cowbell in there. Let's put some more detail, God. Okay. Maybe a better design, you know. More people. Hey, God. Oh, okay, let's get more people here. So God will say, wow, look how many people are here. I mean, that's amazing. I mean, there's so many people who love me. So now I gotta, maybe this is it. Maybe I really, this is my creation. We need more people. Or we say, you know, people here are not really getting with, don't know how to really present this properly to God. That's the problem. Let's get rid of all these people. Just keep the ones who really know what it's about and how to present this properly to God. So there's people working to, you know, cull the population way down to 500 million or something. Those folks are at work too, for sure. And of course, it's all just spirit at work. The bodies aren't doing anything. And, more detail. More fervency. More worship. More thank you, God. Or independence is, you know, we're so completely independent. So God will think, huh, this is so different than what I created. Everyone don't even think of me at all. Maybe I'm the one who's forgotten that I did this, right? So you have that, those folks too say, huh, God, what do you mean, God? I don't need God. This is all just happened by itself. I don't know anything about it, you know. And they say, basically saying, there's no creator. We're not saying there's any creator to this at all. And God will say, oh, okay, they're lacking a creator. That must be me. It must be me. I must be the reason why I'm not accepting it. So they're like saying, I don't even exist. Of course, that must be it. It's all this salesmanship that's going on. We claim, no, we're just trying to be good stewards of the world here, you know. That's our job. Job created as stewards of this planet. We need to be good stewards, good, you know. Stewardship. We're fighting over styles of stewardship, you know. All this conflict. Don't worry, God, as soon as we get rid of these bad stewards, you'll see we're good stewards, and then you'll accept, you'll come down here and live with us and accept, oh, this is my true children, yes, of course. Bodies are what I created, of course. It's just the problem of stewardship. We're not being good stewards. who are sinful stewards are. We're not, well, but they are over there. They're terrible stewardship of the planet. We'll get it fixed, don't worry, God. Almost got to figure the United Nations in there, they'll fix everything up. And then, of course, God will come down here and say, ah. And they say, well, yeah, the new world teacher will come, which is what they really mean is God. or some special emissary of God will come in and say, oh, God really approves of what you're doing. If you just do a little better, then God himself, God itself will say, ah, yes, indeed. This truly is the creation, my creation. I truly created this. This is what I really did. This is what it's all about. Concretization. Form. Absolutely. Just need that new age Messiah to get on the scene here and tweak everything a little bit. Put a little more detail, a little more culling, some culling here, a little detail there. Yeah, and move the chairs around a little bit and say, yeah, it's almost there. It's pretty, we're just about there. God's letting me know that he almost got it here. You know, he's almost got a deal here, folks. You just got to, be a little better human beings and treat one another like human beings, and I so God can say, oh, look at my children, get along so well. They must be my children. They're so, they treat each other so nicely. How wonderful. This must be it. Again, sales trying to sell it. God says, good spirit, you're not fooling. Who are you trying to fool? Who are you trying to get? Wonderful night here. Incredible day. Awesome day. I felt some spiritual depth. And today it was like hot, but some clouds came in and it was just, I could just feel, wow. Felt very powerful today. This feeling of something profound, very profound. And it sort of evoked these memories of past times here, of feeling something profound. And I said, wow. What a great day. And now it's just the wind came up in the evening, this warm wind moving the leaves around everywhere. Crickets are softly out everywhere. It's a very warm evening. Hot day today, 96. Tomorrow will probably be a little less, supposed to drop a bit. Unfortunately, this fabulous fall weather. It's just perfect. As always, at last California, it's been like 4 years of perfect weather here. Unless you need rain, then it's not so perfect. If we need the rain. I got a raincoat yesterday. I thought maybe if I get a raincoat, it'll rain, Of course, reverse things. If I don't get one, it'll rain. Maybe I should wash. Everybody, I think what we need to do is everybody wash their cars tomorrow. We'll have a California car washing day. Let's push this. Hey. Social activists, get on the Twitter, get on social media, make it happen. Let's go viral. Let this video go viral, and we'll have California car washing day, guaranteed to rain, guaranteed to just really pour. Right? Absolutely, it works every time. I haven't washed my vehicle for almost a year now, I think. Maybe that's the problem. Maybe I need to go wash it tomorrow, and that'll get it to rain just really coming in big time. Yeah, if we all do it, it'll work, right? Maybe, maybe not. If build it, they will come. They didn't come. If they build it, the new world teacher will come. If you just build, get ready for it. Oh, whoops, they didn't come. Gee, the United Nations, hey, those of you who can, those advanced spiritual people, you need to get the new world teacher here, so I do everything possible to get here, because we're really, grinding our gears here. Come on, we need the big kahuna here, the big kahuna. And it's got to be a lady, of course. The goddess has got to come. Yeah. And so you can do it. You can do it. You can do it, Yeah. Save us, Save the world. Be a world savior. That's what got into me, from all the currents of that. And that's the problem, The United Nations is more problematical than they realize. Way more so. They've caused a lot of collateral damage, I'm telling you. A lot. better to have enlightened beings on the planet than it is to have the United Nations. Okay, way better. Because people feel it, and that makes a big, they feel the peace, they feel the deal, the harmony, right? And they realize, wow, it's possible. I don't have to be held hostage forever. There's a way I can work at this early. Oh, wow, okay. This is why it would change the whole situation. Not a bunch of artificial intelligence tracking our every move and monitoring everything. That's not the way to do it at all. You know, let there be an enlightened being in every metropolitan area. Or several or whatever. Yeah, yeah. And let the people come and see them. Let millions come and sit and hang out and just feel the peace, feel the harmony. Feel the honoring of our creativity. Feeling the, you know, the resolution. Say, oh, wow. Saw a lady one time in a thrift store. I've said this story before, and this Indian lady, old Indian lady, and I said, you know what, I bet that you saw Ananda Mahima, you know that, this is what I'm feeling. And she was stunned, shocked and stunned. She says, how did you know? When I was a young girl, I did see her and sat with her, and she said, never forget it. I've never forgotten it, just for a minute my whole life, never forgotten it. So this was something totally out of this world, you know, out of this world harmony. Been what, maybe 60 plus years since she, you know, said maybe it could have been 70 years since she'd experienced that, and she said she never forgot it. And I was somehow was able to see that. I don't know how. It's pretty amazing. I don't know. it was intuition, you know, and it's just like, wow. Maybe I was just hoping, but it was true. So it's many, 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 many people, you know, come to see these great teachers, and they take away something that is like, there's something greater than all this nonsense that we're trying to solve the world's problems with this organization and that organization and that organization. No, there's true inner harmony that comes from spiritual practice. That's what really is the answer. So we're working on that now. We're not working on the United Nations things anymore, okay? I had to get out of that, trying to bring the world teacher here, you know, trying to be part of being a reception committee for the world, great world teacher for the new ages. No. That's not where it's at. Jesus is already back here, and he says, I'm here just to relate with you as friends. That's all. He didn't say, I have some agenda. I'm going to set up these big world bodies, these big organizations. No. I just relate with you as friends. That's all. I don't have any plans or anything. So the U.S. says, well, we got to look somewhere else then. You know, got to get somebody. Who do you think is going to lead the U.N. coming up soon? Oh, I wonder who. Yeah. I wonder if it might be the guy that lives in the White House right now. Once he goes into higher ground, yo, hey, chairmanship of the United Nations. What about, hey, here, well, will you accept it? Well, you know, I'm honored, and y'all think about it. Well, maybe I will accept it, you know, if you really insist. If you really insist and give me the power I really, you know, that I need to really push everything through, then I might. And of course, everyone say, oh, please, please do it. You're the only one that can save the world, you know. Everybody loves you. You're so amazing. Come on. You got to do it. Well, if you all really say so, but you got to go along. You got to go along with what I say, right? They say, okay, no problem. Sure. Of course. And then what do you think is going to happen? What do you think is going to happen then? How far away are we from that? About a year, right? About a year. A little over a year. How many count the months? It's October, November, December, January, 4 months and 12, 16 months away from something like that happening, actually. Just consider that, really. That should get you practicing pretty darn right now, right? Oh my gosh. I don't know if people have thought of that one yet. It's not going to be Pope Francis that steps into that position. It's going to be the U.S. president. Very likely, right? Very high likelihood of that. So already been given complete power to set up a global anti-terrorist network of laws throughout the planetary police force, so to speak, and policing, planetary policing against all quote-unquote terrorism, etc., in all different ways, which they will keep expanding and expanding the definition of it, of course. Already has all that power, has a lot of power in the United Nations already, extreme power already. So, you know, he might put a figurehead in, but he'll have the real power of, you know. I saw that from the very beginning. I said, this is, the presidency is not his goal. It's the head of the United Nations. Some others saw that too. Said, oh yeah, this is just a stepping stone. That's all. That's why he treats it the way he treats it. It's like, yeah, you know, whatever. You know, this is beneath me, actually. You know, but you're lucky to even have me here. You know, beneath my pay grade, that is for sure. Way beneath my pay grade. I'm the Pharaoh. Come on, I'm the Pharaoh. Pretty soon you'll see, you know, how pharaonic I am. So that should get you like, whoa, you know, hey, think about it, right? So maybe I need to neither nor it, you know, neither nor this. Maybe I better start neither noring it. And I'm under pressure too. Maybe I better, you know, I want to help out more. It's as Ron Maharshi said, it's the peace you feel. The presence of the peace is how you know a real saint. Not the verbiage. It's the presence of the peace. He says, many can give beautiful verbiage. I mean, the storytelling tradition of India is you have all these mendicants going around. They're great storytellers. This is how they, Mahabharata, the Puranas, whatever, they, the various stories they did, they would tell stories. So all these professional storytellers going around India. So this tradition flourished to such an extent, you have a lot of the people in India who are very gifted at presenting some sort of divine scenario for you, you know? And it doesn't mean they're saints at all. It does not. Yet they're so skillful at it, you know, many people, especially in the West, you know, jump to the conclusion, oh, you know, they're sage, you know. Of course, Indians are looking at the Western and say, you gullible fools, you know. These are just very, very skillful storytellers. So, Ramana said, no, it's not what they say, it's the peace you feel. You have, that's the only indication, the only genuine indication. So he said, yeah, I don't need to say anything at all. You can feel the peace. I know the peace is there. So I don't need to try and sell you on it at all. And he didn't. He didn't try to sell anybody on it. Verbally, right? But it was quiet. Yogananda came to see him. What did he say? Nothing. Very spiritual teachers came to see him. And just, you know, said, I'm not saying anything. I don't need to say anything. I'm not trying to sell you on anything here. I'm not trying to say I'm some spiritual being or whatever. No. Because he knew that vast peace was there and everyone felt it. Everyone felt it. That's not to say that he could not talk. Of course he could talk. Sometimes he did. There's nothing wrong with talking. But again, the peace is the only true indication. The feeling. There's some great massive peace here. You could feel it. Some harmony, some great accord, you know. It's present. That way they could talk about the weather. It didn't really matter. Generally, people ask them spiritual questions. Yeah, so, you know, can you... Rana just was quiet. Yeah, he said, whether I answered the way you want or not doesn't really matter. It's the peace that matters. That's what you'll carry with you. And this is what people carry around the world. They meet these great teachers, and they carry this experience with them. And then when you're listening to them, or you can sort of feel that, you know, they must have felt something at some point somewhere, right? And they may be trying to explain it to themselves. How is this possible? How is this possible? And they try to be spiritual. But you can see that they did come in contact with something. And you say, hey, you know, wow, what did they come in contact with? Harmony, inner, you know, this inner harmony. How is that possible? We think, you know, wow, how is it possible? Well, Jesus has explained it very clearly to us now. We don't need to be in ignorance anymore. We really shouldn't be. We shouldn't still be going around the way we're going around, still like beggars, you know? I mean, Jesus has helped us out to an extreme extent here. And now we realize how it's done. That it is very possible for us now. Continuity fear, honor our continuity fear, honor our creativity. Admit, say, of course, I did. I'm responsible for all of this. Spirit is responsible. And of course, but that's okay. And we're not, that doesn't mean we'll set it down. It's like, oh, it's not like we're admitting to God, like, oh, God, you're right. You know, I did do all this. And God says, yes, see, I told you. Very bad son, spirit. You know, now you got to drop it instantly. You see, that's it. That's what we're afraid of, you know. God's not like that at all. God says, you can keep it as long as you want. It's fine. It's great. I love your creativity here. So there's no pressure really that way. So if we admit it to God, hey God, you know, this is all mine. God says, sure, I know, yeah. But hey, make sure you honor your creativity, man. It's great creativity, you know, you've been using here. Oh, okay, God, thanks. Wow. You mean you're not going to punish me? Punish you? Are you kidding? Look at the fabulous creativity you used here. That's my true creation. Look at the, you used your freedom for all this creativity to try to bind your freedom. Oh my gosh, that's extraordinary freedom, creativity, huh? Oh, wow, really? You're not mad? No. So but you need to honor your creativity. So we say, oh, thank you, God. Okay, let's focus on that. See how easy it is. We look at it this way. So we can either do this or we have some United Nations telling us what to do. Ultimately, it's very sneaky. The United Nations is very sneaky indeed. And they, because they think they're very clever, they have a lot of intellectuals working for them, and they feel themselves as being quite clever. And so they use all, you know, the psychology, and all sorts of in-step psychology. What are, you know, how can we really convince people? And they work through music, a lot through music. Advertising corporations, they have so many different tentacles out that. Have gotten to everybody, really. So you can either be part of that monster, you know, or, you know, accept the truth about the situation. God's not mad at us at all. But God also accepts our desire to set this down. Says, absolutely, I understand that completely, that you don't want to keep trying to do this forever. And that's perfectly fine. And but, you know, you have this continuity fear, so listen to the Holy Spirit. Do the right practices that will honor your creativity, and you'll find this inner peace accord within you. You'll be able to experience, to be able to honor the time in this holy instant, and be able to experience this everything as if it were being released in the now, even though there's an instant of, it seems that it's there for an instant. You're able to get this feeling, and then you will be able to set it down. Ultimately, I'll help you. I'll enable you to settle down, okay? And we'll have a perfect accord. There's no conflict will be there at all. It's simple. And again, it's just either the simplicity or you're going to get the devious, shady nature of the UN with all its artificial intelligence and monitoring, you know, your every breath. They're going to say, well, you've taken so many breaths, that's enough. Unless you're one of the Politburo, you know. And then it says, well, you're helping us out, monitoring, so it's okay. You can have a few more breaths. Maybe a couple more. Thanks, gee, thanks. You had that. It's wonderful. I get to breathe just a few more times before my breath must stop. So people are saying, well, I get to have more breaths than you do, you know. UN said I could. Big Mommy said I could. I get more breaths. How many? Well, couple more. Gee, you're really special. You get a couple more breaths than me. Well, I better enjoy my breaths while I have them. Now, of course, you know, there's not a big audience here for these videos because people are, you know, there's continuity fears. Like, anyway, this is not orthodox. How can you must not speak this way? Well, we thought we had it all figured out. I mean, they're ruining the whole scam here is terrible. God's going to be so angry. It's going to make us set it down immediately. He's going to take it away from us. Oh, really? You did this, Spirit? You know, God, they think, you did this? That's horrible. I'm going to take that away from you. Go to your room. You're grounded, you know. As if God doesn't know that we've been doing all of this all along. This is what they're worried about. They say, no, God doesn't know we're doing this. No, not at all. No, of course we're not doing it. We're just human beings. Yeah, this is all. They're doing it. It's Mother Nature that's doing it all. She did all of this, yeah. This is the battle between the creationist and evolutionist. The creationists say, no, this has all been done by, but they say God, but they really, that's a mistake. It's really God the Son, God the Spirit that's doing this. Oh, but that is true, that it is all creation. It's completely creationist, but it's not really creation. But, you know, they're, you know, a little more, you know, the idea, no, it's just all happening of itself. Nobody knows why it's happening. You know, this is absurd, totally absurd. Because they're saying, no, nobody knows why. No, Spirit's not doing it. What are you talking about, Spirit? You're crazy. No, Spirit's doing all of it. And God knows this. Us always known it. Always will. There's no question about it. There's never been any difficulty in knowing this. It's all been known from the get-go. And God's not the slightest bit bothered or upset about it. So it's okay to admit it, you know. It's okay to say, okay, you know. Sure, of course. It's obvious. Once you start admitting it, it starts becoming obvious. Like, wow, it's very obvious. How could I thought that I could pawn this off as something else? Yeah. But this is what they're afraid of. You start talking like this, they're blowing our cover, man. You know, what the heck? We can't listen to this. We're going to make sure we're good. God, we're good little human beings. We're not listening to this nonsense. The Spirit's saying the Spirit did. We know you did it. We surely know you did it, or we don't know who did it. For sure, we don't know who did it. Either you did it, or we don't know anyone who did it, but not us. No. Not Spirit, of course not. Oh, this guy's talking. He's an idiot. We're not paying any attention. This way, it's hard to get this into the world, because everybody will say, oh, this guy's an idiot. Don't pay any attention to him. No. Because they're still trying to scam God, hoping, yeah, it's going to work. It's got to work. If we don't scam God, this guy's going to take it away from us, saying, oh, you horrible Spirit, how dare you? You know, I'm going to destroy it all, you know. Yeah, because we need to bring this up and act it out, because this is really how we are, you know. This is our fears. We're just expressing our fears, but it's not so frightful to us when we look at it this way. It's very humorous. We transform as we evaporate our continuity fear. Our fear transforms into laughter, into humor, like this, you know, able to look at it and have a good, you know, play with it like it's funny, like put on a show. And this is what we hope, you know. We hope God, God's gonna furious. Oh my God, Spirit, what have you been doing? You've been messing around. You're trying to trick me. Holy cow, that's horrible. Oh. Why have you done all this stuff? Oh my gosh, it's so realistic. I almost was ready to believe it was true. Are you kidding? Now you tell me it's not true. I'm so furious with you. You know, oh my gosh, I'm so upset. You know, we're afraid of the wrath of God. You know, there's no such thing. There's no such thing as the wrath of God. It's our own projections upon the planet. All these earth, everything that happens on the planet is our own projection upon it. Spirit's projection. You know, people in the past, they say, we're little human beings here. There's a big earthquake just happened. There's a bunch of lightning, a storm, a plague, and a dust storm, and all this stuff. The wrath of God. We've done something to get God angry. It's always horrible. Wrath of God. God's so angry and punishing us for us. No. These are all inner projections of our own conflict about this scam, projecting it out upon this nothingness. This is just a dance we call a world. That's how the world appears. Projection. Our own projection, Spirit's mental projection. It appears to appear. I mean, of course, it's not. It's just pure spaciousness. Actually, it's nothing other than that. Pure spaciousness appearing as pure spaciousness, and we interpret it definitionally. Perceptually, you know, it seems to have these defined. Definition to it through perception. Perception is definition. Jesus says this, perception is definition, perception is definition, perception is definition, or attempt to define what can never be defined. How do we define pure spaciousness? You know, how is it actually perceptually, you know, defined? In other words, it's this and not this. Definition means it's this and not this. Of course, we flip it around and say, it's neither this nor is it not this. We're accepting our defense, okay, honoring our defenses. We say pure spaciousness can, let's see, we neither reject that we can define pure spaciousness, nor do we not reject that we can define pure spaciousness. We neither reject that pure spaciousness is definable, nor do we not reject that pure spaciousness is definable. So if you put it in that form, and then again, that's honoring our defenses without capitulating to them, without being held hostage by them. So, you know, we're free. Like for me, I'm saying I was set free, but now I'm sitting across the street from all this long faces and, you know, derangement. But I'm not in their clutches. I'm not in their clutches, but I can see they're there. I say, it's okay, stay there, it's fine. You know, I don't need to change you or do anything. I'm just blessing you, just thanking you. You know, they say, oh, great. So I'm not running away from them. Say, oh my God, I've got to get away from these folks. No. Say, okay, we're good, we're good. And just tell them, yeah, I'm neither, because that's a defense to believe that. What is that? My flashlight just failed. Anyway, I heard something. Huh. Okay. It's maybe it's the long faces. So. Hey, I neither reject that pure spaciousness can be defined, nor do I not reject that pure spaciousness can be defined. Or I can say, I neither accept that pure spaciousness cannot be defined, nor do I not accept that pure spaciousness cannot be defined. But that's the scarier way for them. So you say, I neither reject. So it's a sense of positive. We call it, I neither reject. I'm not rejecting a definition of pure spaciousness, nor am I not rejecting a definition of pure spaciousness. I'm neither rejecting a definition of pure spaciousness, nor am I not rejecting a definition of pure spaciousness. So I neither accept that there's no definition of pure spaciousness. I neither accept it, nor do I not accept that there's no definition of pure spaciousness. See, I neither accept that there's no definition of pure spaciousness, nor do I not accept that there's no definition of pure spaciousness. Now, how can you come up with these? Well, you got to feel you got to, because your job, you're the sovereign, and you're thanking those folks, you know, blessing them and said making it right, honoring them. So you got to come up with some way to say it. So there's a motivation you got to think about. Okay, how do I say it that really will fit? So I neither accept that there's no definition. I don't accept that. I say, I'm not accepting that there's no definition of pure spaciousness, but neither am I not accepting that there's no definition of pure spaciousness. And you can do it different ways. You can just, you know, practice that and see what you like. You know, see what fits for you. I'm not rejecting definitional spaciousness, nor am I not rejecting definitional spaciousness. First we say, no, I'm not rejecting it. And then we say, nor am I not rejecting it. I'm both not rejecting and not rejecting it. You say, I'm both not rejecting it and not rejecting it, which means you're accepting it. But it's said in this negative form, which the reassures our self, you know, our fear, continuity fear. It's reassuring. So I'm not rejecting it, nor am I not rejecting it. So no, I'm not rejecting definitionalness, nor am I not rejecting it. Nor not mean not. Neither not is never saying. I'm neither rejecting it and not rejecting it. So nor means not. Nor am I not rejecting it. You can say I'm not rejecting it and I'm not rejecting it. So I'm not rejecting definition of spaciousness, and I'm not rejecting a definition of spaciousness. So I'm not rejecting, I'm not saying it's not true, and I'm not saying it's not true. I'm not saying that it can't be done, but I'm also not saying it can't be done. I'm not saying it isn't possible, and I'm also not saying it isn't possible. So that means I am saying it's not possible. That's what it really means, right? Yeah, I am saying it, but I'm not saying it. That means I'm saying it. Right? Not saying means you are saying it. So I'm not saying and I'm not saying. This is a way to make it clearer. So I'm not saying it's impossible, and I'm not saying it is impossible. Which means I'm saying it is possible. I mean, I'm saying it is. I am saying it is. It is impossible. If you say I'm not saying it's impossible, then I'm not saying it's impossible. It means I'm saying it's impossible. So our spirit gets this, and this, you know, this honors our defenses. Saying, oh, okay, yeah, we really did. We really had quite a time there, didn't we? Saying it wasn't impossible, right? Yeah, we were doing this dance and saying, hey, we can define pure spaciousness. Absolutely, look at our dances here. Look at our derangedness. That's a good definition, right? Derangedness. And now we're saying, yeah, I'm not saying that it's impossible to define spaciousness. And I'm not saying that it's not possible to define spaciousness. Or impossible. I'm not saying it's impossible, and I'm not saying it's impossible. So this is the kind of work I do, is you go through this and look at it. Say, it's interesting. And when you're doing this, you're showing a commitment to honoring your creativity, continuity, fear. You're showing that you're doing it. It's commitment. And there's an inner recognition of this that you actually are working at it. We're not just saying, "Hey, all you crazy crazy people in the land of craziness. You're all crazy, you know. The heck with you. I'm so sick of you. I don't want to see you again. You're all crazy. I hate you. I hated being there. You're all crazy. Just disappear, you know. This isn't going to work. I say thank you, everyone. I just want to say that I'm not saying it's impossible. I'm not saying it's impossible to find space, pure spaces. And I'm not saying that it's impossible to define pure spaciousness. I'm not doing it, and I'm not doing it. So if I'm not doing something, I'm saying in an indirect way that I'm doing it. But it's pleasant to our defenses, right? It soothes, you know, it soothes them. They say, ah, this is our kind of language. That's great. You know, they get it. The sovereign gets it. That defenses are defenses after all, aren't they? Defenses are defenses. We don't have to transform defenses. We just have to honor them in the light of understanding. And then they don't need to be defenses anymore. You know, they've been honored. Thanks for your service. You know, now you're in retirement home. I mean, now you can relax. You don't need to dance anymore. Some wise therapists get this. Some therapists are, you know, better than others for sure. And in some intuitive way, they're able to sort of help us, you know, in this way. Yes, for sure. I mean, I'm sure there's some good therapists in the world that are helpful, have been helpful. They don't quite see the scope of it we're talking about here, right? They don't quite realize, you know, the fullness of what we're talking about. But intuitively, they say, hey, don't fight yourself, you know. Thank yourself. Thank, you know, whatever you did, you know, just say, did a great job. Say, hey, thank you for pretending to honor, to define pure spaciousness. Is really, you know, all you did a, you know, fabulous dance there of derangement. Like that deranged bee that came here. The bee did this fabulous dance of derangement. I had never seen an insect dance so deranged in my life. It was unbelievable what that bee did. You know, it's just like, wow. It was extraordinary. The bee was like on its head and on its back and moving in circles and just doing this crazy deranged movement and buzzing of its wings. I was just watching, just saying, wow, what is that bee doing? It's out of its mind. It's deranged. And now I see this dance of derangement. The bee was showing me, hey, honor the dance of derangement. Now, this is because they were trying to define pure spaciousness. All this derangement. Yeah, absolutely. So thank all the derangement. You know, thank you, derangement, for this fabulous dance you did. You know, it's really something, really creative, very creative. And they'll say, thank you, you know. Thanks for acknowledging it. That's all we need. We know that, you know, it was just all a scam, but thanks for acknowledging it. Really appreciate it. So you're appreciating yourself, actually. You'll feel appreciated. Feel very appreciated. Maybe we don't need others to appreciate it. It's our own inner appreciation we're really going for here. Thank the dance of derangement. You know, just and yeah, I don't feel conflicted. I feel great. I feel better. It's like, wow, it's very good. It's not like you think of it, I'll say, oh, so you want us to dance deranged again? No. They say, they don't want to keep dancing. I don't want the dance to keep going. No, there isn't any desire for that, but there is this desire to thank them for this. For the creativity involved in it. Massive creativity to appear to be suffering, isn't it? Are you kidding? I mean, Look, all the suffering we've pretended to engage in as some sort of definition of pure spaciousness. Oh, I got cancer. It is really defining pure spaciousness. Holy cow. Yeah. Everybody's dying from something, right? Well, throughout history, we've all suffer, die, sick, die. This is all great creativity, deranged creativity, you know, creativity dancing, a deranged dance of definition, definitional dance of pure spaciousness. Attempting to sell God on concretization, the notion of that. It's very creative, suffering. We've been super creative in our suffering. So, thank all our suffering. Thanks, suffering, for being so creative. It's awesome creativity. Neither do I reject suffering, nor do I not reject suffering. I don't reject suffering. I neither reject suffering, nor do I don't not reject suffering. You see, I both do not reject suffering and don't not reject suffering. Like that. You see? It's a neither nor thing. Yes, I'm saying I'm not rejecting suffering, and also not rejecting suffering means I am rejecting it. That's all we need to do. You know, this is what that the inner self, the inner landscape, you know, needs a landscaper. It says, good, this is what our suffering needs to hear. This, you know, all this dance of suffering we've been engaged in, the massive derangement. Of course, for our standpoint, we're all one, so, you know, there isn't anyone else to get approval for or appreciation from, really. It's all internal, really. It's all in the mind here, so we can do the whole thing right now, right here, right now, for the whole mind, really. As Jesus says, we're never released alone. Jesus says, as we release all. All is released, and we're part of the all, right? It's all one. So the release is felt. This is we release it all. Release all, honor all, forgive all, within us. We don't need to go out to some body there and say, "I forgive you, body." That's not what we're talking about. So when the peace comes, you know, the silence will probably come, right? Because at that point, you don't need to say, you don't need to say that much. You can still say, but what's important then is people will feel the peace. They feel the peace. They feel the harmony. Feel the forgiveness, inner acceptance, the honoring, the creativity, the accord. They feel it. So, you know, then that's what they'll take away as motivation. And when someone tries to say, well, you know, what do they say? You know, well, that doesn't sound, that sounds like level confusion or conflicting. What are you talking about? You say, hey, you know, the peace was there. You know, I felt it. So it's a waste of time, you know, trying to talk it away, really. It's not a waste of time that way. How are we doing on this video? Thank all our suffering, and then say, I neither reject suffering, and I don't not reject suffering. I neither reject suffering, nor do I don't not reject suffering. Neither nor, if nor means don't or no. I neither reject suffering, nor do I not reject suffering. I neither reject suffering, nor do I not reject suffering. I neither reject suffering, nor do I not reject suffering. I neither accept that spaciousness can't be defined, nor do I not accept that space can't be defined. I don't know how that was. That didn't make sense. I neither reject suffering, nor do I not reject suffering. I neither reject definition of spaciousness, nor do I not reject definition of spaciousness. Neither reject it, nor do I not reject it. I neither rejecting this, nor am I not rejecting it. See, I'm not rejecting this, nor am I not rejecting it. I'm not rejecting this. I neither reject this, nor do I not reject it. I neither reject definition of spaciousness, nor do I not reject definition of spaciousness. I neither reject definition of spaciousness, nor do I not reject definition of spaciousness. Reject definition of pure spaciousness, nor do I not reject definition of pure spaciousness. I neither reject suffering, nor do I not reject suffering. I neither reject the dance of suffering, nor do I not reject the dance of suffering. Neither rejecting it, nor am I not rejecting it. Now, the problem is when the wow arises, you'll start getting trapped in the words, thinking, I'm trying to figure it out. This means the wow has gotten very intense. Oh boy, what do we got here? Okay. Yeah, so when you start struggling, trying to think, okay, thinking about it, that means the wow, you know, is gotten strong, really strong. Really strong. Meaning being is very effective. Wow. I neither reject the dance of suffering, nor do I not reject the dance of suffering. I neither reject the dance of suffering, nor do I not reject the dance of suffering. See, intuitively, it's an intuitive practice. As soon as you try to get into intellectual practice, you're thinking about it, that means the wow has gotten too strong. And then you just go back and recognize the wow. Say, oh, wow. And then you can go back to the practice probably. It's pretty easy. Or sometimes. I neither reject the dance of suffering, nor do I not reject the dance of suffering. I neither reject the dance of suffering, nor do I not reject the dance of suffering. I neither reject misery, nor do I not reject misery. I neither reject misery, nor do I not reject misery. And this is easier than saying, well, I both reject misery and I know you're saying like, well, I don't reject misery and I do reject it. See, this is a little too direct. We can say that. Well, I don't reject misery. I both reject misery and accept misery. You know, you can do it that way, but this is it's a little too intense, I think. So it's better to say I neither reject it nor do I not reject it. This is subtle. It's subtle.